What's up, guys? Welcome to Rise to Elevate podcast, interview 43, and I got the GOAT himself, the legend, the dog, man. Listen, Mac Rich, yo, listen, I got to dap you over for the clap. Thank you for coming on, bro, especially with the promo, because we did the little, you clapped and everything, so like, hey, that dude was hard, bro, so just thank you for coming on. We've been trying to do this for a minute now. I know the first time we did it, you were kind of going to fill in for somebody, and bro, it just means a lot for you to even reach back out, because, you know, as we talked before, in this industry, not just YouTube, just in the world we live in, it's cruel, you know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
And I don't mean to come off negative like that. Y'all know me, but I keep it real, you know? So I hope you guys are having a blessed day, though. I wanted to say this before we start. Thank you guys for, and every single person that's been supporting Rise to Elevate podcast. Thank you guys to everybody who voted for us for best podcast of Charleston 2023. You know, win or lose, I really can't explain the amount of love that I can appreciate for you guys. I don't know how, if I said that right, but it's been a beautiful day. But thank you guys again before we start. Mac Rich,
let's go.
Interview 43, let's get to it.
Yeah, man.
So where are you from, bro?
From Charleston, man. That's where I was born. I was born in Charleston, raised Somerville, Goose Creek, kind of all around for a little while. And then later on in my life, close to the beginning of my teenage years, I had a lot of Georgia influence, you know.
So, like, what age were you in Georgia and stuff?
I would say from about 10 years old till 16, 17.
And that's a big change, because if you go from, like, Charleston to Atlanta, like, not just Atlanta, but just Georgia in general, like, was your area like Atlanta?
Yeah, well, it's kind of all over. Originally, it was North Georgia. That's where I was, like, placed in the group homes, and then I was moved from there to, like, Canton, Georgia, and then Augusta, Georgia, and then my final placement where I spent the most time and adopted from was Cumming, Georgia, right outside of Atlanta.
Okay, so you were adopted and stuff like that.
Yeah, 16.
Would you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, man, we could,
I wanted to ask, like, so when did you, like, not necessarily find out, but just, like, figure out, like, what age you were actually adopted? Because I was adopted, too, but I didn't think about it until I was, like, 12, where I was like, wait, I'm moving from this family to this. So, did you ever feel like that? Or
No, yeah, because it was maybe a year and a half after that I got put into group homes that, you know, the mother, I love my mother, she's a great person. She couldn't do the terms that the courts had to get me back and stuff, and so they terminated her rights, and I was therefore put up for adoption in the system. And so I was put up for adoption at, like, 11 or so, maybe almost 12, and then a real hard time adjusting after that, and got in a lot of trouble and got moved around a lot because I was just a troubled kid, and I lashed out, you know. I projected that, and, you know, so I moved around a lot, and then I got adopted at 16. It was 16 when I got adopted, and I didn't find out until, like, maybe 2 months until the adoption, because the family that adopted me, they always came to the group home that I'd been at for a while, the last one, as volunteers. And I was always on the third level, like the good level, because I was really trying to do better and stuff. And so I was there every Friday for their pizza movie night. And over the months and months of me going there, I was always the kid that went every weekend. And so we just built a relationship. I built a relationship with all the kids, everybody, you know. So it was a whole thing. And then I guess it was already kind of a plan. And it made sense now that I'm older, because I see how, like, it went from just pizza movie night to where I would go on Saturdays, too. Yeah. And I had kind of special, in a way, like, I would go and the other kids wouldn't, and I didn't understand why, but it's because the group homes and them already had worked out, but they wanted to adopt me.
Yeah.
And it was kind of obvious that I was cool with it, because the way I blended, it was, like, awesome.
Yeah.
And so it just worked out how it did, and then they sat me down one day when I went for a pizza movie night. They sat me down with all the kids and their family. It was like, look, we want to adopt you.
Wow.
And, like, gave me a breakdown. How'd you
feel? Like, were you, like, you know, not just joyful, but were you, like, more appreciative of being that you had someone actually give you
I felt like for one moment in all this, since I'd been in group homes, for one moment, like, everything wasn't spinning, like, I wasn't lost, like, I had a reason now. Someone cared enough to make me have a reason. I wasn't just, like, a kid that was in the system and had people who just got paid and was social workers or care workers or foster parents to take care of me. Like, these were people who genuinely cared for me. And so for a moment, it let me focus in and realize that, like, you know, I have something, you know, worth being for. I wasn't just living recklessly.
Yeah.
I really had, like, that real feeling of, like, love.
Yeah.
And it made me appreciate like life in such a different way. I love myself more then because I was like, I'm worth loving.
Yeah.
You know, and it showed me that. So it was everything for me. Mm-hmm. That really, you know, made me.
Right. And I'm glad, man, because I'm in the same boat, bro. It's crazy that, you know, you find different people that went through what you went through, but a whole different story.
Facts.
You know what I mean? Because mine's kind of relatable, but just a whole different story.
Yeah.
So I don't want to be, you know, because it is a touchy subject.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't want to ask certain questions to
throw the interview
off, but it's definitely, people would want to know about that.
Yeah.
So like, what middle school and stuff did you go to around here?
I went to Greg Middle School, Greg. Ghetto ass Greg.
Yeah,
man.
Dude, it was crazy. I love Greg. It was fun. I think Greg was more of like a life-changing experience than going to school because the environment was crazy.
Man, it honestly taught me how to be social. Right. Everybody's so like social. I had so many friends, man. It was great.
Were you the dude that was like the best at PE and stuff?
No, I was the kid that was like funny and got in trouble but wasn't on bad terms with the teachers. They knew it was like, you're being an asshole right now. Right. I was like always really jokey type and funny, and for the most part I fit in with every crowd. I was one of them that kind of blended with like jocks or emo kids or you know how the whole groups go. Like I was kind of cool with everybody.
Did you feel like school kind of was a safe haven from being away from home?
Yeah.
Because of that.
I couldn't wait to go to school.
Yeah.
I couldn't wait to go to school. I love going to school because it was like different. It wasn't like I'm just at the foster house or the group home just thinking about like I'm in a group home right now. I can't do this or I can't do that. And so I had some like sense of like just life. That was my life. That was my out. That was me hanging out. Was going to school.
Oh, that's dope, man. So what about high school and stuff? Where'd you go there?
Cherokee High School in Canton, Georgia.
Wow, so that's a big change.
Yeah, that was different, bro. It was cool, man. Everybody's so fucking country there stuff. It's like, it's crazy, man. It's awesome, though. I played football, and like, I really got
What position you play?
Wide receiver, and then I would sometimes like play safety when I was needed, but
kinda
I didn't
like
play. Yeah, right. Hey, I didn't play for like crazy long because, like I said, I was a troubled kid, and that high school was before I'd gotten adopted and knew about any of that, and so I ended up getting kicked out, and like got kicked off the team, and it was a whole thing. Yeah, bro, it was bad, but it was all right, man, because I learned, you know. Mm-hmm. It sometimes you just gotta learn the hard way.
Go through those,
you know.
Bad stuff.
And I did. Got kicked out of school, man. Got kicked out of that placement, and that's when I started moving around. And then.
So what was after high school? Was that when you started like rapping, taking it more serious, or was rapping already kind of like in your realm?
It was kind of in my realm, but I never rapped. Like I created my own music ever since I was young. Like. Any rap song, 50 Cent song, Eminem song, Tupac song, Bone Thugs and Harmony, anything, I knew them. Not all the Bone Thugs.
I know. Because
them things are hard, bro. The hooks, I'll kill the hooks, bro. Right. I swear. And like, I knew them word for word, and I would get excited. And when I was real young, I would run in my mom's room just to show her.
Yeah.
Like, Mom, look, I just learned this song word for word. And when I would rap them word for word, I felt so good, like, for some reason. And so, like, it was always loved hip-hop, and like I loved the feeling and the energy it gave me, and it felt like it was me. Like the same energy it just radiates is what I radiate. Just that energy, that great feeling that hip-hop at least gives me, what it makes me feel.
But I mean, that's when you look in like your music video, even the audio of it, Meek, that thing is, dude,
Meek's hard.
I was just showing my cousin, I'm like, bro, listen, rewind this back, bro. Listen to what he just smoking.
It's catchy as fuck, man. I love Meek, bro. Meek is, it actually took a minute for it to grow on me. It was like, I knew it was a hard song, but for the longest, like, I would know a song's hard, but I would be so focused on the next that I wouldn't really give the song the time it needed. And so Meek really taught me to, like, focus on one song and, like, stop dropping aimlessly, because, like, I would drop all these good songs. I dropped an album that was 24 songs, and they were all could have been that one song.
Wow.
If I would have marketed it.
Right.
And so I just smartened up a little bit and was like, I need to stop dropping all these really good quality songs aimlessly and put all my energy and time into this one. Mm-hmm. And then what can I do in a year if I put all my time, energy, and money that I can into one song?
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee I'll do way more off that one than I would if I dropped 20 all year.
Yeah, that's
aimlessly
crazy,
with
man.
No marketing.
That 24 songs in the album, that I know there's.
I was 24 years old last year when I dropped it.
Yeah,
and it's called I'm Chosen, and so it was a big statement for me. Like, It was everything.
Well, then that's what kind of shows you that it's more of a passion than just doing music. You know what I mean?
For sure.
Some people really do music for the clout. I mean, you know it. Y'all know what I'm saying. But it's for sure, more just like
it's a thing.
You really have a passion. Like, you're laying it out. And, dude, this year is your year. I don't care what anybody says.
Yeah, it's just getting real.
Like, you've done a lot of stuff already. I think you performed twice already.
Yeah, I've done three or four shows. Yeah. I've actually slowed down.
Just in Charleston.
No, Atlanta, Augusta.
Yeah, bro, you've been doing your thing, bro, and it's only March.
Yeah.
Doing your thing, bro, and I think the next big level for you, and I've told you off the camera, is like, you know, you got to start doing more, not just more, but different content and really reaching out to people.
That TikTok stuff.
All it takes is what? One song.
That one song,
and then
bro.
That's it. So, dude, and you got a dancer to dance to one of your things, right?
Yeah, he's from somewhere in Russia or something
to him.
Like that, bro.
He be doing some crazy
man, his name's
stuff.
42 Blacktop on Instagram, and he makes all types of dance videos, and he's the truth, man. Go check him out.
Yeah, that's dope.
And he did a dope ass, like, freestyle break dance. He was spinning and did handstands in the snow. Bro. And like a bubble coat. It was the coolest shit, bro.
That's hard,
dope,
bro.
Yeah.
But your marketing is genius too, bro. And I think a lot of people don't give you flowers for that, because even I get some
attention
from
real.
You. So it's like, keep doing your marketing and what you're doing, and keep being more consistent. But other than that, like, other than Mink and you know, the 24 album thing that you dropped, is there like anything else that you have like worked up right now? And then, like, you got any...
Yeah, I have a few big things in the work that I actually was, like, I haven't really posted about, because I'm not the type to, like, if something happens, whether it's solidified or not, to just be like, this just happened.
Yeah.
Because, like, I don't know, it's just, it's corny to me, to do it. Like, I'm more humble, I guess, you know, for myself and mine. That's not how I want to be.
Right.
And so, I haven't really, like, posted, but yeah, man, I got some big shit in the works. I got a feature with Skinny from the Nine dropping this year that's already...
Okay, I know who that is, yeah.
It's already finished, solidified, I have the record back, I have everything, we have an agreement for it and everything. It's a whole real thing. And then I also have another feature, OG Young Simi.
Okay.
From, he grew up... Came up rapping with Denzel Curry and Raider Clan.
That's
and
dope.
All that shit.
So you've been collaborating more than anything this year.
Yeah, man. That's what I'm focused on, is like nothing but big feet. I'm focused on promoting Mink.
Yeah.
And then the songs that I do drop, I want to be nothing but major.
Yeah.
So like I'm talking major features, and I'm probably honestly, I mean, anything could change. Obviously artists know, you know, schedules change, things happen, grow, whatever. For the most part, I only plan on dropping like maybe two songs this year and then focusing on straight marketing.
Yeah,
but obviously that could change. You never know what could happen. You know, something blow up.
Some future collaborators you think, like, or who would you?
I would like to work with. You mean like just big wise, locally,
anybody,
just anybody?
Yeah, I mean, I think people would want to know, especially inspirational wise.
Because
I heard you talk about
you know,
Bone Thugs and Harmony. That's
a big. Yeah, that's crazy, man. Honestly, you know, I don't know. Do you know Xavier Wolf?
Yeah.
You know? Clint, hey, I want a song with Xavier Wolf.
That would be
hard.
You would match his energy, too.
Literally.
And I feel like y'all would float. Yeah, go ahead.
The artistry style that we have is the same. Like, we're that type of artist that we're not like R&B. You know how there's like
there's
types. Yeah, it's that aggressive talk shit, like, I am who I am type energy.
Man, and I feel like I would match that. If he said I don't know who Xavier Wolf is, if he sees this, bro, he's going to... I'm like, bro, man, listen.
Some people don't, man. It's
crazy.
They don't. Some people aren't into that type of rap.
Yeah.
You know, it's a different type of rap. And so
I feel like his is.
How about I Don't Know Jeffrey?
I've heard some.
Oh, bro, I Don't Know Jeffrey's crazy.
They did a thing together.
Yeah,
right?
they're like really cool. They rap together all the time. They're both from Memphis.
Yeah, they're both.
So that's honestly like that whole really Memphis in general style. A lot of 3-6 was a lot of my come up too, and so like Memphis style like type beats and shit is my whole thing. Like I hear something and I'm instantly just inspired. I don't know, it just gets me, bro. Nothing like a Memphis style beat, like a Young Boy.
And then you got what's his name? He's rising up right now. This is Memphis. I forgot his name. He has the doll.
Oh, is it a
Duke
Chucky
Deuce?
Doll?
Duke Deuce.
Yeah, Duke
He's
Deuce.
He's getting big in Memphis.
Yeah, Duke Deuce
so
is hard, man.
Some
Duke
big
Deuce.
People. That's
what
cool.
the fuck?
Yeah,
you killing that
got
shit,
some hard. And the police thing, yo, shout out to him, too.
Yeah, that's hard.
But other than
that's
that,
crazy.
You know, the music thing, like, what else do you focus on? I know you got a, you know, friends and stuff like that. And you do
yeah,
things
man.
Outside of that. Is there, like, anything else you kind of, like, think you want to do in the future? Other than music related?
Yeah, there definitely is. I've been like talking to a few different people about possibly trying to get into like acting or scenes or even cameos to like try to get into that type of industry, because like, I don't know, I feel like I kind of have a personality that could be captured.
Yeah.
Would be good for certain characters. I feel like someone might see and be like, that's the energy.
And I saw the music video you did where you and Mugga Man shot.
Yeah, and Plug Jr.
Yeah.
Shout out Mugga Man and Plug Jr.
Yeah, shout out to him, man. I need to hit him.
That's my brothers, man.
But you did stuff like that, and the acting was super. Like, y'all, it looked like a movie.
Yeah,
that's
kind of
what drew me in, you know?
That's how it was, a whole breakdown was, and really, like, you know, we all creatively came up with the concept and idea. It was just like a group thing, all the homies. Mm-hmm. Cameraman too, Preston Richardson. Mm-hmm. Shout out to him for the music video.
Yeah. That's YP.
YP 900K. Mm-hmm. Yeah, man, that's my dog too. And it was a really creative thing that we all did, and it was beautiful, man. Shout out to my homie Zach that was willing to be the dude trying to break into the trap house and get beat up on camera. Yeah, we didn't really beat him up.
No, but I know what you mean.
You know, to be that guy and be on camera as like that dude, you know?
Shout out to him.
Yeah, you the truth, Zach.
Yeah, because I forgot who tried to get me to... Oh, yeah, I ain't afraid to talk about it. My dog Rado tried to get me in this music video. That man's good.
Hey, I've been there, bro. Shout out Go Diego. I've been one of those in his video. Literally, he was at a Thai restaurant. They stuck the Thai restaurant up. And I was the dude at the register. They got jumped in the fucking lobby.
It's funny you thought, like, that's so, like, dog. Do you believe in, like, not saying you're who you are, your face card, but do you think that is probably, like, the most important thing in your life? Because, like, as you can tell, if you're that dude who's being stuck up or whatever it is you got going on, you're going to forever be known for that kind of
thing. Yeah,
so, like, and I don't mean to talk low, but I just got serious, but like, do you think that your face card is really important in the world we live in, or do you think it's like your social media now, or like,
I think it's your face card and your word, whether it's social media or in person, but I think your face card has a lot to do with it, because there's a lot of people that, you know, have followings or this and that on social medias, but can't do much in real life. You know, and so there ain't nothing more than like face to face, you know. People fuck with you face to face, or people rock with you face to face, excuse my French.
You're good.
You know, then I think that's way stronger than a like or something.
No, yeah. Definitely, man.
For sure.
Even like
face card.
Yeah, face card.
Face card.
I agree. Cause
face card to put you in rooms.
It would do a lot more. Way more. And even just a simple phone call just because off your face card would mean a lot, you know. And that's why I know you're up next this year, because like, you put in the work, man. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. I wake up, I get a text. It's you. Yep. Hey, like, comment, share my stuff. Like,
man,
I like that.
I got you, bro.
Yeah, that's hard.
Anytime I see something, if it's someone that I'm involved with or I rock with, artists, anybody, you. Anytime I see it, I try to engage as much as I can, because I ask that of people.
Right. Yeah.
And so I have to, you know, be that. If I can't ask somebody to rock with me and not rock with them, you know? So that's just, that's not, it don't work.
But you still got to do your job, you know?
Yeah,
for sure. Not necessarily your job, but you got to promote yourself and do, you know what I mean? And you do a great job with that.
Marketing is important, man, nowadays, with social media and stuff. And, you know, you got to think about it. On all these places you can distribute music, there's thousands of songs being uploaded daily.
Yeah.
And thousands of artists promoting their stuff daily. So,
right.
You know, you can't just be like dropping songs, man. You got to make content. You got to make something that in the first 3 seconds of a video, like you were saying, captures them and brings them in. There has to be a reason for them to connect to it. They're not going to connect to your music because they don't know it.
Right.
So that's why you connect something in. You make these like funny, cute, it don't matter. Your choice of marketing videos to get their attention and view them in, and then, you know, if they rock with you, they rock with you.
And that's why I had to do the OU Little League, because you got that stuck in my head.
Little
shout out to my dog Frank and my girl. We SpongeBob people, so when I saw
man.
That, at first I thought it was a SpongeBob thing, and then it just instantly turned, and I was like, yo, that, and you picked the right wordings too, because, I don't know, that was fire, bro. You're
it was hard, man, and it was genius. Honestly, shout out to CapCut Artists. It's a very simple app to use. CapCut.
It's
all types of templates, man. It's why not do it? Do it, man. There's all types of things. TikTok, get on that TikTok stuff, man.
Yeah,
for real.
No, definitely.
TikTok's very important.
So we'll talk. I want to actually bring that up too before I ask a little bit more questions. But where can we find you on social media and stuff like that?
Oh, social medias, man. You got me on Instagram at MacRich Music on Instagram. You got Spotify at MacRich, Apple Music at MacRich, Facebook MacRich, and how you spell MacRich is MAC. R-I-C-H. That's M-A-C-R-I-C-H.
Right, okay.
And, you know what MacRich stands for?
No, yeah, let's talk about it.
Making a change.
I like that. Was that from, like, just you, or is it you got inspiration?
We'll just say it's inspiration. Me and all the homies and whatnot just coming up and just called me Mac. That just became my name, you know?
Make a change. I like that, bro. Because, like, I think
and
about
Richie
Mac
is my name, you know? People know me by that don't know me as Mac, right. I'm gonna hear that all the time. No, they're gonna be like, Richard, like, who the fuck?
Right, and I'm not gonna lie, and now that you kind of told me your name, I'd rather call you Mac, man. I feel like Mac fits you, like, that's who you are.
Everybody knows me, my job, my boss calls me Mac. Right. It's just me, that's who I am, you know? Right.
No, definitely.
If I get called my normal name, I'm like,
what the heck? They must know you
weird.
Really well.
Yeah, yeah, it's weird really if someone calls me my real name. Yeah,
I'm in the same boat. So, you know, not saying that, like, you're not performing a lot this year, because I know earlier you're saying you're only probably dropping a little bit amount of songs, but do you, like, have any big performances coming up soon or anything like that?
Not specifically, no. I am open to bookings. Anybody, I'm trying to hit more of new areas. I'm more picky and choosy with shows. I don't want to keep performing the same locations and places that I have been, because I've noticed through years and years of performing, I see a lot of the same faces, which is great. You want to perform for the people that rock with you, but you also want to perform in front of a lot of new people, and I haven't really done that a lot until these past like year or two, and so this year I want to focus on hitting new places. Yeah. I'm still going to touch base with those places that made me, but I have to expand because the world is bigger than where we are. Mm-hmm. Right now, and the only way I can be there besides promoting myself on social media there is by tapping in with promoters in the areas
Non-stop.
And going and doing shows and investing and going on the road and
giving
and
your energy
out of
bro, because anytime I see Mac Rich on the stage, bro, this man, you're an animal.
Crazy.
I'm not dapping up, but bro, you shed your energy, dog, and that's one thing why I feel like promoters are missing out, because I'm glad we're talking about this. You're different, bro. Like, every time I see what you do and anything you do, you have passion behind, bro.
Facts. I appreciate that.
No, it's real stuff,
bro. I work hard to do that, too, not half-step, to do something 100%.
Yeah,
bro. So that means a lot to hear that. Thank you.
No, and I think we all know. It's not just me that should be saying that, though, because I know some people look up to you, bro.
Facts, for sure.
You know, and I just had to bring that up because it's real. But do you think that, you know, not necessarily saying travel is after that, but do you think that you're going to try and do, like, you know, maybe teach someone how to make music, or like, I'm kind of giving different questions.
You know, yeah, that's actually great that you said that, because I have been thinking about doing something exactly like that, because I've been through a lot of different things. I've paid for a lot of different things that wasn't all the way there. I've been through the ups and downs. I've seen the real and I've seen what's not. Mm-hmm. And so I've been through a lot of stuff regarding my music that's not good, you know, and went a lot of the wrong ways that taught me the right. And so I feel like I have a lot of knowledge that other artists in the area and other places don't have, and the basic answers to their questions that they don't get, and I don't want them to go learn out and do it. So I've been thinking about like doing consultations with artists. That's not even really like big, crazy, or expensive consultations. Just more of like, what have you done? What do you have going on? Let me see all of your music you got going on. What do you do on social media wise to promote yourself? To get a basis of where they're at in their world that they're trying to create. And then from there, I give my professional insight on, this is what I've, through experience, I think if you did this and this and this with the pieces you got, you could build a bridge to cross that and you could get there. And try to put all of that into perspective for them, because as an artist that's never done none of this or really left where you're at, it's scary. You don't know what you're doing, because
no,
I've
just
been there. And so I don't want, you know, I want
to
be able to help artists that have been where I'm at and are where I'm at, and show them like, yo, it's okay, cool out. This is what you got going on. This is what you can do, and these are your options. And like teach them and almost mentor them, I guess I could say, in a way, if it comes down to it, on how to shape their career and really find that craft, that niche.
That hit.
Yeah,
or several.
And do it, Or even review music. Just sit down one-on-one and like listen to your catalog and give you professional insight. Professional insight means
actual
honesty.
Experience,
honesty. You're going to get honesty, and you're going to get exactly what I would feel, you know, is going on with this track.
And that's
a
fact, bro, because I'm it's crazy you say that. Shout out to Young Deji, I love you, bro. He actually put me on and stayed in my head. He does live music reviews too, but he was like, how would you, and he kept it a buck with me, like straight 100. How are you gonna, and he didn't say it like directly, but he said, how would you do music reviews if you never made a song? Me personally, I've made SoundCloud.
Like,
but like you know, so I'm like, now because I was about to say, yo, we should do it, but I kind of respect that because you've made hits, like, you've got some good songs, bro. So,
yeah,
like,
I appreciate that.
The fact that, like, you even think about taking time out to review other people's stuff, even Young Deji and a lot of other people that do it, you know that you have to be experienced with it, and it's professional. It's not like you're just out here winging it. Like, you've been performing, you got skinny with the nine and stuff like that. You know what I mean?
It's been years, man. Years
been
doing
grinding.
This. So. have real insight that I think would be really helpful.
No, definitely. Know? I'm glad I asked that.
Life-changing.
Yeah, very life-changing. Matt, you know, make a change. I love that, bro. You should get that tatted or something.
At some point, man, it's actually crazy. I'm thinking about getting a grill, but not that crazy. Yeah. I'm not going to ball out for anybody. If you ever see me in a jewelry, I'm not going to be the type to go buy no expensive ass jewelry.
Right.
Because I'm going to buy me and my mama and all my people a house before I ball out on some jewelry.
But it's still good to...
So I'm going to get some, but they're going to be SIs, mm-hmm. and they're going to say Mac, and it's going to be gold, but they're going to be SIs, but they're still like $700, $800, $900.
Right.
But so if y'all see me, don't be like, oh, he's got VVs, because I do not got no VVSs, and I'm not out here fake flexing. I'll tell you how it is. Those are SIs, and I'm balling within my budget. Yeah, I'll buy a house before I buy a real grill or chain.
As long as you're happy, which is actually, you know, I gotta
speak on it because that's the thing nowadays. People try to call me out.
You have to.
And I already, you can't call me out. I did it.
Yeah, my dog Frank pulled out a chain. He was like, "Can I pull out a chain tester on one of my interviews?" And mm-hmm. dude was like, "Yep, this is fake and stuff." I was like, "Oh
shit!"
Straight exposed. But no, it was crazy. I can't remember how exactly we're done. But no, that's actually gonna lead to like one of my last questions. How can you, when you wake up, can you always be yourself?
Yeah, bro. I flow with it. It's horrible. I feel like it bothers people sometimes because I'm just how I am. Like I'm the same way, man. Always.
Yeah.
I'm the type of person that wakes up an hour early, gets to work an hour early because I'm excited.
Yeah, right.
I'm just excited to get to the day, and it's right. I've even posted it on Facebook. If you follow me on Facebook, you've seen it. It's like, man, I came to the weirdest realization that like I always wonder why my brain's trying to get me to hurry up and get to the next step or get this done or get this done, or I can't wait for the next day. I can't wait to get to work and get this week over with. And it's because I know what's coming and I know the things that are going to come to me by me being who I am and having this vision and this route and executing it. And so I can't wait to get there. I know what's coming, and so I'm ready for tomorrow. I can't wait for tomorrow. Right. I know exactly what I'm going to do, and I know what's coming, and so I'm excited. I'm excited for the rest of my life.
You may have bad days, too. You know,
I do all the time.
Yeah,
I do all the time.
We're going through the same thing, and then I feel like you don't, and I know, not trying to sound weird or anything, I know you don't care about likes and stuff like that. Like, there's one thing I know. You just keep going. You know?
Yeah, but I'm a post regardless.
That's what we do. That's how you know you're up next. That's why we're in front of the screen, and that's why next time it'll be in a short period of time frame. I'm going to bring you back, and we're going to talk more.
Yeah, man.
And way more stuff behind the scenes, bro. Way more stuff.
For sure.
But no, is there anything else you want to talk about or anything? I just kind of wanted people to get to know you. Like I said, you're going to come back next year. Or not even that, but a couple months, and we're going to talk about
when it works.
What's been going on and fly you out maybe to wherever we are.
Yeah, bro.
For you to perform.
You never know.
Shout out to Palmetto Network. Can't believe I'm saying that. I can't wait for the... Y'all don't even know what's in store. It's going to be beautiful. And even for you, bro, I'm going to bring a lot. I will change the world. I know this is not my interview, but I had to just tell you guys,
bro.
This is
real. I'm proud of you, bro.
I'm proud of you,
awesome.
Too, bro. Thank you for even coming.
Yeah, man.
Mac Rich, the man himself, the legend, the GOAT. And y'all, if y'all don't know who this is, please just look him up on social media. Like he said earlier, he's on everything. Mac Rich Music, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, everything. Snap, maybe, I don't know. You know, everywhere.
Everywhere.
But again, I love every single one of you guys. Stay true to yourself. The only way to achieve your dreams is through you. Nobody else is going to do it. You got to get up every single day and you got to want it. Because if you won't, I will. Peace.
Let's go. Rise to elevate.
Rise to elevate. Thank you, Mac.
Yeah, man.
Peace.